This is the Biblical Mind Podcast, produced by the Center for Hebraic Thought. Honest five-star reviews help others find this podcast. Visit the magazine at thebiblicalmind.org for articles and videos that explore the deep structures of Scripture.
The Hebrew Bible, the Jewish Bible, says a number of different things about the possibility, perhaps, of an afterlife. And it's a little complex to explain in a sentence or two. So there was originally this idea of the Sheol, the idea of the underworld, which was an idea actually was common in the ancient Near East. Although the way the ancient Near Eastern people thought about it was, meaning the Babylonians or the Egyptians, Sumerians, was not exactly in any way how the was thought about in the Hebrew Bible, because they believed in gods, gods above in the regular life and gods in the underworld. And Jews or the Israelites didn't believe that. It wasn't part of their Bible.
So is it fair to say that, that to put it in today's terms, the Hebrew Bible actually has a quite striking countercultural view of what's happening in the underworld and the heavenly realm in some ways, at least when it comes to death, especially like I think most people know about Egypt, and you're supposed to pass through some kind of passage where your heart is weighed against the feather of Maat. Is that the body or the soul that's being that's passing through, I guess?
Not being Egyptian myself, although I've read some of their writings. I'm not 100% sure, but the Mesopotamians and the Egyptians believed that the life in the underworld after one dies is kind of like a faint imitation of the life in this world. Is that you have a you do have food and drink, and the food and drink are actually often provided by the descendants, or the live descendants, who put it on in their tombs. And there's also in Egypt there was magical spells and rituals that were done before to hopefully conduct a comfortable physical and spiritual existence after death. But none of this, the Hebrew Bible is primarily absent when it comes to any kind of description of what goes on. And there's no real details what happens after death. The only hint, maybe in the entire of some kind of existence after death, is in this famous story in 1 Samuel 28, when Saul engages a necromancer in Endor to raise Samuel from the realm of the dead.
And I noticed you said raise there, and I think you're following the language of that story.
Yes.
Where Samuel says, "Why did you bring me up?" Right?
Exactly.
Which for most Christians, when we read that story with them, they're like, wait, bring him up from from where? Like, well, let's talk about this, right? So, yeah, how do you read that passage? Because it is a fairly cryptic passage on what's going on there.
Yeah, well, it's, you have also, I mean, before we get back to that, there's Abraham and Jacob, patriarchs, right? When they died, it said that they were gathered to gathered to his people. What does that mean? Abraham was gathered to his people. It's not like he had any people, to be gathered to. So it suggests, it probably suggests in terms of both of them, that they were in some way reunited with their families. Okay, but that's a guess. There's no real thing, and you have these. You have some statements in Psalms, if Psalm 6:5, I think, says in Sheol, who will give you thanks? There's no remembrance of you.
Right, right.
And Psalm 115, verse 17 says, the dead do not praise the Lord, nor those who go down in silence, meaning to the grave. You know, so.
Well, even there, silence into the grave. Is that using the term Sheol as well?
No, it's just the silence. It's just your day.
Oh, into the silence.
Okay?
Yeah, okay.
We'll go down into the silence. But they mean this, apparently the silence of the grave.
Yeah, so I think that's an important point, though, as well, that that when we say Sheol and we say, well, what is Sheol? And we're like, well, it gets used quite a bit in with some elasticity. It gets used in different circumstances. But is there a physical thing that Sheol is a metaphor of or that becomes a metaphor from?
The word Sheol, although it's common in the Hebrew Bible, does not appear in any other ancient Semitic language. We really don't know. You have to kind of like draw these little things here. So on the assumption that what happens to in 1 Samuel 28, when the female necromancer, some people call her a witch, but when she brings up the dead Samuel, okay, she describes it as like a divine figure, and then, and then she says he's the appearance of an old man covered with a robe, and Saul knows it's Samuel, who then says to Saul, "Why have you disturbed me?" There's maybe that's this sense of maybe he's been in eternal rest, So that's the only hint we have. But then Samuel goes into, what's called Samuel there, whatever you want to say. The word spirit is not used. So whatever that voice says, is he gives a speech of several verses explaining that God is fulfilling Samuel's prophecy given when he was alive to Saul. And there's no difference. If you read those verses, there's just no difference between what Samuel said when he was alive and what he's saying when he's dead, except that at the end he says to Saul, "You and your sons will be with me tomorrow."
Right. which they were.
Which they were, right. Yeah. And that's the interesting thing about why this kind of thing was forbidden in Israel, because why did the divination of this type or these necromancers exist elsewhere in ancient Near East? Because it was thought that the gods could be somewhat manipulated by magic or by divination. And there was in some way, if you could tap the phone line of the gods,
you knew
what the gods' plans were, then you could circumvent them. And the whole idea of it being forbidden, in Israel, is that if you have it in Israel, you're treating God as if he was a pagan deity, and he's not. You cannot circumvent God's plans. Doesn't make a difference what you. And therefore, if you behave this way, you're behaving as a pagan.
Yeah. I think that's a really important point, because I think a lot of people will read that passage and try to squeeze it for the blood of the metaphysics of the afterlife. And it really, like all of the Hebrew Bible, and I would say all of the New Testament as well, is just really uninterested in describing what is going on in this realm called Sheol. You just get little hints all over the place.
Right. You have to answer what's not going on.
Yeah, exactly.
Ecclesiastes is a verse that says, there's no functioning, nor thinking, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in Sheol to which you are going. Right?
So, and I think for Christians are going to struggle, because they're going to think of, well, when you die, you go to heaven or hell, and which is is one way of looking at the text. It's not even necessarily the majority way of looking at the text amongst biblical scholars. But so to hear even this is to say, like, well, but is it a good or a bad place? And we might say, well, it's just a place. You know, like, is my house a good place or a bad place?
Yeah,
what's my house? It's where I'm at. It's where I live. You know.
Yeah. Well, it's right. It's where. We very rarely, it's interesting that it was common in among ancient Near Eastern peoples to bury their ancestors in the house.
Oh, yeah, yeah, under the floor, right? In the, yeah, and in the living space.
Right, and I think you only have one example of that, of someone being buried in his house, I think, in the Bible, in the Hebrew Bible. And it's... So they were buried outside, and there was no, you know, there was no cult of the dead. There were no rituals that were done, or the rituals, or anybody who did such things was doing pagan rituals.
Yeah, yeah. I think this is, I mean, for me, like methodologically thinking about these issues, this is the most important topic. They're surrounded by cultures that talk endlessly about what happens in after death, and then has entire ritual systems built up around what happens after death. And so I do wonder if the silence here is a critique and also guidance, like this isn't where your focus should be in some ways.
Yes, there is a, and it's interesting that there is a metaphor, which, and apparently not just a metaphor, but sometimes it's means something real, actual, of the idea of God raising up from the dead. So
right,
there's,
right.
So in the Song of Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 32, God is quoted as saying, "There is no God with me." It's an important point. "I kill and I make alive. I have wounded and I heal." So the idea of "I have wounded and I heal" means I've wounded, and then that same person I can heal, or I heal, and then I kill and I make alive, meaning that I can kill somebody and then bring him back to life.
Yeah.
And this is actually, you almost have one of the very similar verse in Hannah's prayer.
Yeah, Hannah, right, exactly.
Right. She says, "The Lord kills and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and brings up."
Yeah, and grave there is Sheol, right? So
yes, it's Sheol, right? Yeah. That's right. He brings down to Sheol and brings up.
So yeah, I think John Levinson was the first person I heard who pointed this out to me, that that idea of resurrection is right there in the poetry of the Torah and then gets repeated by Hannah.
Yes.
Interestingly, that exact same poem by Hannah, or that song of Hannah, gets repeated by Mary in the New Testament in the Gospel of Luke. She almost line for line goes through and rehearses that song of Hannah. Yeah.
Interesting. The thing here about Hannah's prayer is that it expresses the Israelite view that only God is responsible for life and death, and it rejects all the ancient Near Eastern polytheistic notions of the underworld, right? You know, that God's control over life and death is consistent with his omnipotence. Just as he controls the world, he can, according to his will, he causes death and revives life. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
So I mean, in many ways, we could go on and on about what the Hebrew Bible doesn't say about the afterlife and kind of where it does direct our attention, which I think that's an important point that you're making as well, is like, it's not just what it doesn't say, it's where it is telling us to think about things. In Hellenistic Judaism, and I want to go to Hellenistic Judaism, or what we call late Second Temple Judaism, things shift significantly.
Yes, you do have an apparent shift going on. The only unequivocal voice concerning resurrection comes from one of the latest passages in the Hebrew Bible. That's probably from the time of the Seleucid persecutions of the Jews in Israel, which is approximately 170 BCE. Which is from the last chapter of Daniel, Daniel chapter 12, verse 2. "And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, and some to reproaches and everlasting abhorrence." And at least that's the best translation I can come up with.
Yeah.
But even that leaves a little bit of something that's not clear, and that is, does this relate only to the righteous and the wicked? And how about all the rest of us, right? So it's, but you're right that in at this time, you have a verse in at the end of Ecclesiastes, chapter 12, where it says, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit, the Hebrew word ruach, right, which is like the spirit, returns unto God who gave it. Which is a very interesting text in terms of the immortality of the soul, which really you don't have before then. There might be some kind of hints in the Hebrew Bible to it, but there's nothing definite. And then, so then you have this verse I just mentioned in Ecclesiastes, which is probably also is from the Hellenistic period, probably about the 3rd century. The Hellenists came in at the end of the 4th century, and they divided the Levant between the Ptolemies and the Seleucids, and the land of Israel was somewhat back and forth between the two until the Seleucids finally grasped it strongly and took over, and you end up with the period of persecution of the Seleucids of the Jews by this time. Right. Jew, of course, being a word that comes from, despite its spelling, comes from Judah. So you had the Judahites who survived in the Hebrew Bible after the Israelites were, the North Israelites were taken captive by the Assyrians. And then by the time of the Hellenists, they're now called Jews or you die, you know. So it's which still returns and retains the name Judah, which will become eventually Jews.
Yeah, and it's a complicated story, but Jew is it's just as much regional as it is ethnic, and includes different tribes. And there's a lot going on with that term. There's a recent Oxford book that came out by Jason Staples, which is an interesting history of how this term is being used in this period. But we know we at least know who is being pointed to by the Seleucids, these Greek and the Ptolemies. So these are kind of Greek rulers in regions to the north and the south of Israel. And I guess the question is, okay, so, you know, it's hard to make a case that there's something called a soul in the Hebrew Bible. And even when we say things like nefesh, it's turning to, you know, it's pointing to physical aspects of the body. And even if we want to say, yeah, maybe there's something like that being hinted at in ruach, which is wind or spirit, you know, and these analogies, I guess the question would be, the Hebrew Bible is so hesitant to like really play up the metaphysics of soul and afterlife. I guess, why do you think Jews seem to pick up a lot of Greek ideas and then start interpreting their own views through what we consider classical Greek categories of ontology, the nature of being itself?
Yes. Well, I think that a major unspoken issue here is the idea of theodicy, the idea of God's justice despite what is going on in the world. And I think that this discussion of the soul appeals to Jews of that period who are going through a very rough time. After all, when we look around the world, we see things which just are not fair. Now you can say life is not fair, but it's if you look at it and you see that people who are we know to be really good, fine, wonderful people, caring about others, doing things on others. Some of these people have great tragedies that happen to them in their lives. Mm. And some of them have, you know, a great amount of suffering, which leads to their death. And so but we who believe in a God who is good and who was just, say, well, this can't be part of God's justice. So there's something greater here. And there's something which is extremely appealing to us. And that is that if in this life, in this physical life, there is justice that is missing, then that will be fulfilled in a future life, to which our souls go back to, or right? Because our souls come from God. It's like there's this godliness part of us inside of us, which is in a way returned or returns to God after the physical death. Mm. And I think that that becomes a very attractive idea in the Hellenistic period. And there's also, yeah. For the first time, you hear in this period the classical Hebrew term for the afterlife, or I should say the classical Jewish term, which is Olam Haba, the world mm-hmm. to come. And you actually have that in the Book of Enoch, which is from around 160 to something, in the second century BCE, yeah. where it says, he, meaning God, proclaims unto you peace in the name of the world to come. Then you have texts which discuss this. You have the Wisdom of Solomon, Ecclesiasticus, which is apparently written somewhere between 50 BCE and 50 of the Common Era or the Christian Era. But the souls of the righteous are in the hand of God, and no torment will ever touch them. In the eyes of the foolish, they seem to have died, and their departure was thought to be an affliction. But they are at peace, for though in the sight of men they were punished, their hope is full of immortality. Another verse there says, but the righteous live forever, and the reward is with the Lord. The Most High takes care of them.
So I think a lot of Christians are not aware of, some of them might be, but not aware of all of these Jewish texts that are written just prior, a century and a half, 2 centuries prior to the time of Jesus, and then after as well. They might know about the Talmud and the Mishnah that's a little bit further down the line. But these are texts that are actually trying to integrate some of these ideas that come across from the Greeks. And they I think of Wisdom of Solomon or Ben Sira as like books that feel very much like Hebrew biblical text, but then they have these little bits in them. They're like, oh, no, that's great. That's definitely a Greek idea being worked in there. Is there a movement within Judaism to kind of disentangle Greek thought from what they consider, the biblical thinking of the Tanakh, the Hebrew Bible?
Yeah, yes, but essentially you mentioned Ben Sira. And Ben Sira actually has a pretty traditional idea of the going down to the grave from the Hebrew Bible. But you have, somebody like the great Hellenistic Jewish philosopher Philo Judaeus,
right?
Who describes how the souls of the righteous return after death to their native home in heaven, or even in the case of rare individuals like the patriarchs, to the intelligible world of the ideas. So you can see like a little Aristotelian stuff in there.
Yeah. Doesn't get much more Hellenistic than that.
Yeah. But you do have also resurrection being spoken of in a certain, you have in the Second Maccabees, which is written about the middle of the second century BCE, where he speaks of resurrection for those who are faithful to God and his commandments. There's a famous story there of the woman and her 7 sons who are all tortured to death because they will not accept the Seleucid king Antiochus as God. Mm-hmm. And as a 4th son of the woman is being tortured to death, he says to the king, I will wake to an eternal life and you will never wake. So that's...
And for Christians, these texts we're referring to, most of which appear in what we would call in the Protestant tradition, the Apocrypha, right? Those texts in between Hebrew Bible, the Old Testament, and the New Testament.
Apocrypha and Pseudepigrapha, yeah, right.
Yeah, and there's many more texts outside of the Apocrypha, Jewish texts from this period as well, and beyond, of course. Okay, so I think we have a good picture of how things changed. If we were to jump ahead in time to maybe medieval period, and certainly we want to get to today, like where do Jews generally fall on these issues? And I know the medieval period, especially like Maimonides, is going to have a heavy influence on where Jews fall today on the topic.
Yeah, well, look, it's important to emphasize that we're talking here about a very small portion of even the texts that deal with these issues. Right? Mm-hmm. The vast majority of Jewish texts from the Hebrew Bible on through the Talmud into the medieval period, into the modern period, are almost totally focused on how to act in this world. It's this world that we know about. It's with the whatever is going to happen in the future, or in our particular futures after we die. That's in the feeling is that's in the hand of God. Yes, there becomes a major, shall we say, one of the Maimonides has one of the 13 principles of Jewish faith. He has the resurrection of the dead. Yes, that's there. And in fact, it's there also in liturgy from the Talmud on. The Talmud is from material collected from around the end of the second century of the Christian era through the seventh century, let's say. And then you go on with the people who are commenting on that, etc., like Maimonides comments on it very significantly. So in the liturgy today, the traditional Jew, the first thing the traditional Jew says in the morning is, I acknowledge, O sovereign of all life and existence, that you have in your compassion restored to me my soul. Because it's the feeling is that when you go to sleep at night, your much of your soul, if not all of it, is taken away and is restored to you in time for you to wake up in the morning.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. So there's like a direct line of influence there. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not a, right. So you in traditional, yes, these ideas appear in traditional Judaism right on through today. So you're talking about Orthodoxy and even conservative Judaism. If you're talking about the two of the three major movements, Reform has treated this a little differently. I should just explain briefly. Orthodoxy believes that the Torah comes directly from God, and the rest of the Jewish Bible was inspired by God, however you want to understand that. Mm-hmm. And the Talmud was inspired by God. But conservative Judaism believes that it's more of a God-man dialogue, these texts. And when you get to, and therefore the commandments are something which is more situated in a historical fashion. And even though conservative accepts a lot of the commandments, there's also they've made some changes. And then when you get to Reform Judaism has the idea of that really all of these, that God exists, but that everything that is said to be a commandment is really up to personal autonomy, meaning people can decide for themselves what they're going to do. Now, therefore, what they end up is, in terms of belief, is that they have very different beliefs, and they reject the idea of resurrection, but, and you'll find this interesting, they do accept the idea of the immortality of the soul.
Okay. So, again, you can see it probably some kind of direct line of influence there through Enlightenment thinking as well. Yeah.
But I have to tell you that there's a lot of disagreement about when exactly, even in traditional Judaism, when does the soul completely abandon the body after death and rises to heaven? So is it immediately upon death? Does it linger for the week of mourning? There's a week in Jewish tradition of mourning. And then there's a year which follows that, or which goes up to actually to the end of 11 months, which is a mourning, but not as intense as the first week or 30 days. And does it still linger during the year of mourning the soul? I don't know, but I can tell you something personal. I was alone with my grandfather of blessed memory in the hospital room when he died. And as I held his lifeless body in my arms, I had the eeriest sensation that he was looking down at me from above. Mm-hmm. I'm getting chills just thinking about it. Near the ceiling of the hospital room, here I am looking at this body, and I feel that he's looking down at me from above. Now, I can't say, you know, it felt like it was his soul looking down at me. But it was like him, right? And so, you know, I can't say for others how they should feel or what they should believe. But for me, it was an affirmation of the belief that there is an immortal soul. Hmm.
I think it's interesting that the New Testament authors, most of whom it's widely believed were Jewish, many times who are writing to a mainly Jewish audience with some Gentile overshot, who are talking about the world to come, the new heavens and new earth, the reunification of the heavens and the earth, the kind of Isaiah's view of the new heavens, new earth, that they almost never, with maybe a handful of exceptions, but almost never refer to any of this Hellenistic Jewish literature. They never quote it. They never cite it. They never rely on it for a point that they're making. And so there is this question as to whether how much, you know, this line of thinking has really influenced the New Testament authors in that first century after Jesus, and how different, you know, maybe this is one of another ways in which there's been a parting of the ways between these two sibling religions that emerge from first century Judaism. But it is striking to me that they don't engage this literature at all. They only go back to the Torah. They only go back to, you know, Zechariah and Isaiah and Ezekiel, etc.
It is interesting. If you look at early Christianity as a Jewish sect,
right?
Which I think it was.
Yeah, exactly. Let's be honest. It was. Yes.
Yes, I agree. I mean, it's one of the reasons that I am a religious Jew, why I read the New Testament. I was interested in reading about, you know, this, you know, the words of this particular sect. But if you look at the various sects, I mean, look, in Judaism, I say rabbinic Judaism takes a lot from the Pharisees who came before mm-hmm. them. Mm-hmm. In terms of these ideas, idea of resurrection. In fact, one of these things is one of the issues about the soul and resurrection is a major difference between the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Right, mm-hmm. The Sadducees didn't believe in this, and it was a big difference of opinion between them. But again, if you, you know, look at the Talmud, then you see all these different opinions of different viewpoints about this. There's a one of the notions we haven't talked about is the idea of hell, right? Mm-hmm. The idea that the wicked are punished,
right,
by being denied the spiritual afterlife, which the righteous will come with. And so what happens to the wicked, right? So in there's hell is called in Talmudic times up until modern times, really, Gehenna, right. Which means the valley of the, it comes from the valley of the son of Hinnom, which is in the Bible, in which it's on the outskirts of ancient Jerusalem. It's
still a beautiful little valley today. Grass covered, right. Yeah.
Yes, in which in biblical times, children were sacrificed to idols, and so this became the Jewish understanding of, I mean, this was like the worst possible thing that could happen, and so this becomes the name for hell. But this notion is never given any kind of official status.
Mm-hmm.
It's also not even central. There's a statement that says there will be no Gehenna in the world to come. And then there's according to another Talmudic text, the souls in Gehenna, the world of the wicked, are punished for up to 12 months. And then they continue on to the Garden of Eden, which is another term for here used for the ideal world to come. And right. Yet another text says that those who remain wicked are annihilated.
Hmm.
And by the way, there's also a significant statement about the Gentiles, which is in the Talmud, which says the righteous of all nations have a share in the world to come.
Hmm.
So,
so yeah, I mean, and this would be a whole nother episode of that. Hell's probably not a word that translates anything in the New Testament, because again, it's Gehenna that's being used there in the New Testament by for the same reason. I think the big difference is though, Gehenna and judgment of the wicked is actually put on an absolute timeline in the New Testament, where it sounds like it's left more ambiguous in rabbinic Judaism. So,
well, but it becomes, in terms of judgment, there's an individual judgment which occurs to each individual after the end of their lives. But you know, we're coming up on Rosh Hashanah, right? The beginning of the Jewish year, right? With Yom Kippur, Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement following quickly after it. And that is, there's this period that we're in right now, which is a period where Jews should be doing repentance, because mm-hmm. every year God judges in the individuals who shall live and who shall die, who shall be sick, who shall be well, etc. Okay, and that's, and so we in this judgment, it's said that on the judgment is written down on, it is the common tradition, on Rosh Hashanah, but it's not sealed till not 10 days later on Yom Kippur, okay, the Day of Atonement, which means you have these 10 days. That you
get it straight.
You know, you really need to do what is right. And the repentance is not something which just means that you pray to God and ask forgiveness and you fast on Yom Kippur. It's before that. You be according to the Talmud, right before that, you must ask forgiveness from anybody who you have offended. And if you have to pay compensation, then you have to do it before Yom Kippur, because on Yom Kippur already, if you haven't done it, then your prayers on Yom Kippur will not be accepted by God.
Hmm. Okay, well, Rabbi Dr. Jerry Unterman, who is one of our senior fellows at the Center for Hebraic Thought, thank you so much for helping us to understand a very complex topic over, I don't know, a couple of millennia of literature and thinking. Thank you for your time and your wisdom.
Thank you so much. I'm honored that you asked me, and I wish you and all your listeners that they have a not just a wonderful day, but a wonderful life, and a life in which we all exhibit the best of ourselves in our dealings with other people.
You've been listening to the Biblical Mind podcast, exploring the deep structures of Christian scripture. For more, visit the magazine at thebiblicalmind.org. Subscribe to this podcast at all the usual places so you never miss an episode. Thank you.